It's a Northwest Lifestyle Weekend on KOMO News. Here's Tom Hutler and Shannon O'Kelly with more IRG Health Talk.
Time for our next guest is Dr. Pamela Paley, gynecological cancer surgeon at Overlake Cancer Center, talking today about ovarian cancer. We are talking kind of a cancer-centric show today, Shannon, and this is another very serious topic that is well worth discussing.
Yeah, I think this particular topic is early detection. You know, it's so important because this is one of those silent cancers. You want to find it early.
All right, here is Dr. Pamela Paley and Shannon O'Kelly.
Dr. Paley, welcome. How are you doing today?
I'm well, thank you.
Oh, well, thank you for joining us. Tell our listeners about your practice and your area of interest.
I'm a gynecologic oncologist, so my specialty is taking care of women who have cancers of the ovary, uterus, cervix, and other cancers that affect females in the reproductive organs. I also care for women who have increased risk for those cancers.
Wow, is that a new area of medicine? Has that always been around? I mean, yesterday, weren't you just a gynecologist and took care of cancer? So is that an area of specialty now?
It definitely is a subspecialty and has been for a number of decades.
Tell our listeners about your training, because it sounds like very extensive training.
Well, after 4 years of medical school, there is 4 years of residency in obstetrics and gynecology, and then another 3 to 4 years of subspecialty training for gynecologic oncology.
So, I mean, you're in charge of treatment, surgical removal if needed, aftercare, the whole continuum of that cancer of the female organs?
Correct. And then surveillance going forward for a person's entire life.
And how'd you become interested in this?
In my residency training, gynecologic oncology was actually my first rotation as a resident at Duke. And I was just really stricken by what these women were going through, how strong they were, and really wanted to make a difference.
And it sounds like you have a lot of passion for this area. Tell us about ovarian cancer. Let's start there. And tell us signs and symptoms, who gets it, who's susceptible to it, etc.
Right. Well, ovarian cancer has been considered for decades to be a silent killer. And unfortunately, in 2017, it sort of remains a silent killer, and that's because women really don't have early signs and symptoms. The symptoms that do occur are pretty nonspecific. In other words, they're not specific to ovarian cancer, so they can be caused from many other different conditions. And those symptoms would be abdominal bloating or feeling full when you've eaten very little, having abdominal or pelvic pain that's persistent, change in bowel function or in urination. But again, those symptoms are common with a number of other conditions and don't necessarily mean a woman has cancer. And because these symptoms are so vague, what that means is that 75% of women who are diagnosed with ovarian cancer are diagnosed in an advanced stage where their cancer can be treated, but in the majority of cases, it will eventually come back, and the majority of women will succumb to their cancer.
Oh, wow. So let's talk about this. Let's really get very specific if we can. So what you're saying is by the time the symptoms are discovered, or someone like yourself who's looking for them discovers them, the cancer is at an end stage. When you say end stage, are we talking like 1 through 4? Is 3 and 4 end stage? What is an end stage ovarian cancer?
So I wouldn't say end stage. I would say advanced stage.
Okay.
Again, because the cancer is quite treatable. The problem is that in most cases, it'll eventually become resistant to therapy down the line and become fatal. But stage 3 and 4 are the stages we're talking about. And again, I would consider that advanced stage.
Is there any research or methods that folks are working on to try to identify this earlier, so when maybe stage 1?
There is a lot of interest and a lot of effort in developing more effective screening strategies, but none of them have proven to decrease the mortality rate of ovarian cancer. Probably the biggest area of progress has been in identifying women at increased risk based on their family history the availability of genetic testing and then preventing cancers in those women who are identified at being high risk.
We're back with more with Dr. Pamela Paley and Shannon O'Kelly after this on KOMO.
It's a Northwest Lifestyle Weekend on KOMO News. This is IRG's Health Talk. Back to Tom Hutler and Shannon O'Kelly.
We continue our discussion on ovarian cancer with Dr. Pamela Paley and Shannon O'Kelly.
So, Dr. Paley, we were talking about diagnosing ovarian cancer, and you mentioned there's a genetic component or hereditary component. But tell us about genetic testing.
Right. Well, we talked about the fact that it's good for women to be aware of the signs and symptoms of ovarian cancer, but probably even more importantly, women should really delve into their family histories with their physicians, and their physicians should be equipped with the knowledge to identify those women who may be at increased risk of breast and ovarian cancer or other cancers, and send those women on to a genetic counselor for genetic counseling and testing.
Is there been a genetic marker that's been found that indicates potential ovarian cancer?
There are many. Actually, the initial mutations were discovered in probably now getting close to 20 years ago. And those mutations are BRCA1 and BRCA2. Those specific mutations are associated with a significantly increased risk of breast and ovarian cancer, but also other cancers. And these cancers tend to occur much earlier in a woman's life than cancers that are not genetic. So it's very, very common and it available in day-to-day clinical medicine to have the availability of genetic counseling and testing.
Why don't they just automatically, when a woman turns 16 or 18, whatever it is, why aren't they just tested for these genes?
Well, that's a good question, and we may eventually get there. At the current moment, women who have family histories that are suggestive are women that go on for testing. But I also want to mention that any woman who has developed ovarian cancer should definitely undergo genetic testing, not only to provide information for her family members and allow them the opportunity to prevent cancer, but also knowing if someone's ovarian cancer is related to a genetic predisposition will direct their physician to more effective therapies.
Interesting stuff. I'm as you're talking, I'm thinking, so what if a woman's father's mother had ovarian cancer? Is it passed down from the father's side? Is it on both sides of the family, so to speak?
Absolutely. And that's a great question, because not all women recognize that hereditary predisposition can come from their father. It doesn't have to come from their mother. So it's important to know the extended family history. And again, that's why it's important to bring that family history up with your physician.
Man, I just absolutely love this show and doing this show, because it's a fascinating time in medicine. I mean, to be in healthcare today with technology and gene therapy and identification, I mean, you're going to find a cure for this, or you're going to eliminate it hopefully one day, huh?
I certainly hope so. And you're right, it is an exciting time. And genetic testing for cancer predisposition has really opened the door for what we call personalized or precision medicine. In other words, not just testing for a predisposition, but testing an individual affected by cancer to look at the molecular makeup of their tumor and direct their physician toward more effective therapies. And the list of therapies, targeted therapies that are being FDA approved is just increasing exponentially. So it is a very exciting time.
Well, Dr. Paley, again, thank you for your time. And I'm so glad there's physicians like you out there in the community working on this stuff. Thank you.
Well, thank you. It was my pleasure.
Well, Shannon, as we talked to Dr. Pamela Paley and earlier to Dr. Lean, it makes you feel good that people who are going through cancer of any sort are in such good hands. These are really, really good doctors.
Well, we know from everybody that's come on, Tom, early detection, eat healthy, exercise, and prevention. What do they say? An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, right?
Absolutely.